Good morning, Crossroads Church. It's really great to be back with you again this morning. I know that you're in for a tremendous treat. Last week we had Bishop Zach from Kampala, Uganda, sharing the word with us. He's back this Sunday. I've been through his message and was super blessed. So I know it's going to bless you again. Please join us in worship, and with our children's church and youth, we're in for a great time today. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this wonderful day to worship you, to come together as a congregation, and to hear your word. We ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's go. He has overcome, yes, he has overcome. We will not be shaken, we will not be moved. Jesus, you are here. Yes, Lord, you are here. Yes, Lord. Yeah, yeah. God is fighting for us, God is on our side. He has overcome, yes, he has overcome. We will not be shaken, we will not be moved. Jesus, you are here. Carrying our burdens, covering our shame. He has overcome, yes, he has overcome. We will not be shaken, we will not be moved. Jesus, you are here. I will live, I will not die. The resurrection power of Christ alive in me, and I am free in Jesus' name. Carrying our burdens, covering our shame. He has overcome, yes, he has overcome. We will not be shaken, we will not be moved. Jesus, you are here. Oh, I will live, I will not die. The resurrection power of Christ alive in me, and I am free in Jesus' name. I will live, I will not die, I will declare and live too high. Christ revealed, and I am healed in Jesus' name. Oh, oh, yeah, yeah.
You're welcome to clap alongside with us.
Hallelujah.
Lighting up the kingdom, that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, the enemy's defeated. And we will shout it out, God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness. Lighting up the kingdom, that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, the enemy's defeated. And we will shout it out, God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness,
lighting up the kingdom
that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, the enemy's defeated, and we will shout it out,
For God is fighting for us,
pushing back the darkness, lighting up His kingdom, that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, the enemy's defeated, and we will shout it out, I will live, I will not die. The resurrection power of Christ alive in me, and I am free in Jesus' name. I will declare and lift you high, Christ revealed, and I am real in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name.
Jesus, the powerful name of Jesus, the name above every other name, at the mention of that name, every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that He is Lord. Amen and amen.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds Thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, Thy power throughout the universe. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. And when I think that God His Son, not sparing, sent Him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, He bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. How great Thou art, how great Thou art.
our Father who is in heaven.
Yes.
Don't interrupt me, I'm praying.
But you called me.
Called you? No, I was just praying our Father who is in heaven.
Fear, you did it again.
Did what?
Called me, you said our Father who is in heaven. Here I am, what's on your mind?
But I didn't really mean anything by it, you know. I was just, you know, praying my prayers for the day. I always say the Lord's Prayer. It makes me feel good. Actually, it's kind of like completing a task.
All right, go on.
Hallowed be thy name.
Hold it. What do you mean by that?
I don't know. By what?
Hallowed be your name.
It means, good grief. I don't know what it means. I just pray it, you know. It's just part of the prayer. By the way, what does it mean?
It means honored, holy.
Hey, that makes sense. I never thought about what hallowed meant before. Well, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Do you really mean that?
Sure, why not?
What are you doing about it?
Doing? Nothing, I guess. I just think it would be kind of neat if, you know, you got control of earth like you have control of heaven.
Have I got control of you?
Well, I go to church.
That isn't what I asked you.
Oh. Well, oh boy. You know, we're only a couple of minutes into this, and I'm starving. I need a baguette.
So, any thoughts on the self-discipline issue?
Alright. Well, I guess I have some bad habits, like watching too much TV, playing too many video games. You know what, now that I think of it, I really could cut some of those things because I'd really like to be more free.
Good, finally we're getting somewhere. We'll work together, you and I. Some victories can be truly won. I am proud of you.
Look, Lord, I need to finish this up here. I mean, this is taking a really long time, more than it usually does. Give us this today our daily bread.
You could cut out the bread. It would help you lose weight.
Hold on. Wait a minute. Hold up. Why is this like criticize me day? Here I was doing my religious duty and all of a sudden you break in and remind me of all my bad habits? You know, praying is dangerous. You could wind up changed.
That's what I'm trying to get across to you. Keep praying. I am very interested in the next part of your prayer. Well, go on.
I'm scared too.
Scared? Of what?
Because I know what you're going to say.
Try me and see.
Forgive us of our sins as we forgive those who sin against us.
What about Anne?
See? I knew it! I knew you'd bring her hope, God! Look! She told lies about me and my family. I swore I was going to get even about her.
But your prayer, what about your prayer?
I didn't mean it.
Well, at least you're honest. But it's not much fun carrying that load of bitterness inside of you, is it?
No, but I'll feel better as soon as I get even. Boy, have I got plans for this neighbor. She'll be sorry she stepped foot into this neighborhood.
You won't feel any better. You'll feel worse. Revenge isn't sweet. Think of how unhappy you already are. But I can change all that.
You can? How?
Forgive Anne, then the hate and sin will be Anne's problem and not yours. You will have settled your heart.
Oh, you're right. And more than I want to get revenge against Anne, I want to be right with you, but... All right, I forgive her. Help her to find the right road in life, Lord. Somewhere, some way, somehow, help her show her the right way.
There now. Wonderful. How do you feel?
Well, not bad. Actually, not bad at all. Actually, I feel pretty great. Maybe I'll finally get a good night's sleep.
You're not through with your prayers, though. Go on.
Oh, all right. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Good, good. I'll do that. Just don't put yourself in a place where you can be tempted.
What do you mean by that?
Don't turn the TV on when you know your room needs to be picked up. Also, about the time you spend with your friends, if you can't get them to stop gossiping about everyone and the dog, perhaps you should rethink the value of those friendships. And another thing, your neighbors and friends shouldn't be your standard for keeping up. And please, don't use me as an escape hatch.
I don't really quite understand that last part.
Sure you do. You've done it a lot of times. You get into trouble, and then you come running to me. Lord, help me out of this mess! And I promise you, I'll never ever do it again.
Yes.
You remember the last bargain you made?
Yes, I'm ashamed, Lord. I really am. I remember saying that, and if you give me more time to study for my math test, I'll never skip my devotions again.
Well, and what happened?
Well, let's say the teacher won an award, trip away to Hawaii, all expenses paid. So let's just say my math test was postponed.
But you didn't keep your promise, did you?
I know, I'm sorry, Lord. I really am. Up until now, I thought that if I just prayed the Lord's Prayer, and I could do whatever I like, and... But I didn't really expect anything to happen like this.
Go ahead and finish your prayer.
For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Do you know what would bring me glory? What would really make me happy?
No, but I'd like to know. I want to please you. I can see, I know I made a mess of my life and all, but I can see how great it would be to be one of your followers.
You just answered the question.
I did?
Yes. The thing that would bring me glory is to have people like you truly love me. And now that I am truly your God, there is no telling what we can do together.
Lord, let's see what you can make of me, okay?
Yes, let's see.
Woo! Guys, the moral of this skit is when you say the Lord's Prayer, don't just repeat it, pray it.
All right, Chelsea, it's recording. It's recording.
Okay, yeah. So,
yeah.
Be more vocal with my hands.
Yes.
Like, just extend more and louder.
Yeah, extend, but just reach out more.
Reach
you know?
Out
yeah.
more.
Use your
okay.
space a bit.
Okay. One, two, three. Hey,
hey
you! Oh, wow. That actually hurt my hand. Are you okay?
No, I'm okay. It's fine, babe. Okay, so, remember actually last week we talked about looking to Christ and
yeah.
what that means is just understanding what's already... inside of you that we
yeah.
have that Holy Spirit.
I do remember that.
Remember
yeah.
how we like now we have, you know, full access to God?
Yeah,
like,
the 24/7.
The 24/7,
yeah,
like it never ends.
Yeah.
I think that's crazy good.
Yeah, I love the 24/7. Like 911, whenever you need them, it could be 3 a.m. Well, I don't know what the emergency number is here, but in the States it's 911. So whenever you need them at like 3 a.m, it's like 911. Hey, what's up? Can you help me out? You know, like
no.
It's the same thing.
It's not the same thing.
But kind of, because like,
no.
ask, what?
No, because...
It's like, what?
They're not there every millisecond.
Well,
God's every,
almost.
Every millisecond, second minute, second day, hour, day, morning, 4 a.m., 5 a.m., 6 a.m., every single millisecond,
no,
hour, minute, day...
4 a.m., 5 a.m.
God doesn't need technology.
Well,
that's
okay.
the difference.
Yeah, that's true. He has the Holy Spirit.
So now...
That's definitely better than technology.
God has deposited... Boom, here's my Holy Spirit. I'm going to give you my Holy Spirit. God's presence is with us and lives in us.
Oh, so,
so
we're
now,
carrying him with us.
All I got to go is, hey, Holy Spirit, good morning. How are you today? He says, hey, Jordan, I'm good. How are you? I'm like chilling. It's great. You know, like I have this conversation with God every single day. And I don't audibly hear it, but, you know, I'm always just talking. And God does reveal things to me, which
yeah.
I absolutely love. Okay, so, yeah, do you know Matthew chapter 7?
Yeah.
6 and 7 were... God is on the big mount, you know, the Sermon on the Mount,
yeah.
the famous Sermon on the Mount, where he talks about lots of different things. He talks about, you know, how you should pray. He talks about, you know, lots of different things, like giving to the poor, loving your enemies, all kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's one part, right, in chapter 7, verse 7, where he talks about asking, seeking, and knocking, like very basic stuff. And he says, ask, in verse 7,
mm-hmm.
and it will be given to you,
yeah.
Chelsea. If you seek, you will also find. If you knock, the door will be opened to you. And verse 8 just reiterates it like this. For everyone who asks, receives.
Hmm.
The one who seeks, finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. I love that. This is Jesus speaking. It's in the red letters. Like, it's him. Jesus is speaking these
yeah,
very words.
Right.
So, I love how simple, how straightforward, how... uncomplicated this is
yeah.
because he gets right to the point and he tells you and he tells me like, hey, if you need something, ask me. Now, when we read in scripture, you'll find, you know, it says that
The Father knows our needs before we can even ask. That's how good God is. But God also wants us to ask Him. And He wants us to experience, I think, how good He is and how loving He is toward us.
Yeah.
And so when I read this, it just makes perfect sense understanding now that Jesus has died on the cross for my sins. He rose from the grave. And He's seated at the right hand of the Father. And He's given us His Holy Spirit, His presence. Like, God lives in me by His Holy Spirit. Wow.
Yeah,
and now
amazing.
Now He's saying, ask me.
Yeah.
Ask me. Like, hey, Chelsea, are you struggling with your husband? Do you need more patience? Ask me for patience.
I did this morning. I
know
I
get an amen?
I know what I did this morning.
We're blessed in the city. So that's what I'm saying. Like, you know, this excites me because all of a sudden it's like, hey, sometimes I don't feel like reading my Bible, Chelsea. Sometimes I wake up in the morning, all I want to do is sleep in, and then when I get up, all I want to do is drink coffee and have a baguette.
Sit.
No, have a baguette.
Oh. Well, I like to sit with my coffee and in silence.
Good luck with that.
But you know what? What you were saying in there.
Yeah.
Of ask.
Yeah.
And seeking.
Yeah.
You know, like, it reminds me of how we've been wearing the same, like, four outfits this month.
Why?
Except for when Fabian came in and helped me because she realized I had, like, four shirts I was wearing.
Thank you, Fabian.
Thank you, Fabian. So shout out to her because she saved us. But anyways, it just reminds me of how we've been asking God to provide and to bring all of our suitcases and luggage and everything to France since it's been so difficult with COVID. And God hears our prayers.
Right.
And He's going to provide those suitcases. But it may not happen in our timing or the way we imagined it to happen.
That's why our luggage never showed up when we wanted it to.
Yeah, I mean, God knows. He has His ways.
So basically, what you're saying, Chelsea, that our luggage, our 10-plus suitcases back in Ireland, have not arrived in France because it's not God's timing?
Yeah, it could be that. I mean, I did ask for more patience.
Okay. But it will happen.
I've been praying for more patience, so you know.
Well, yeah.
Sometimes when we ask for patience, He'll give us a struggle to start to work up that patience in us.
That really helps me because I was getting very impatient. And I just said it. I need to ask. God, give me patience with this whole luggage. That even though I'm wearing the same three t-shirts every week, give me patience.
Yeah, and it doesn't just say ask once, you know. We're supposed to be in communication with Him. So we're supposed to continue to walk with Him.
I like that.
So when we're being persistent, we're asking Him, we're talking to Him, you build a relationship with Him.
I love it.
And you said the Holy Spirit's in me. So, like, obviously the Holy Spirit doesn't want to be, like, silence and me not talking to the Holy Spirit, but they want to walk with us in communion, in relationship. So we should be seeking and asking and they will provide in their timing.
Wow, yeah. I love that. Actually, in John chapter 14, verse 26 and 27, Jesus even says that the Father will send an advocate, the Holy Spirit, who will teach you all things.
Wow.
And He also says to remind you of everything I said to you, including this.
Even in hard times.
So, like, it's exactly it. Our luggage is not there. Oh my goodness. What do I need to do? Ask God. God, give me patience. God, provide our needs. Why do I come to that conclusion? I think I know now. Now that the Holy Spirit's in me, the Holy Spirit's purpose is to remind me of everything God has spoken and to pull me back to my dependency on Him.
Yeah.
You see, what I'm noticing, Chelsea, is that every day, more and more, I'm realizing how much we need to depend on God.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not sometimes, it's really always.
Yeah.
You know, I'm finding more and more that no matter what I'm doing, where I am, I need God. I need Jesus every day of my life, every hour, every minute, because sometimes I mess up or I get impatient and I throw the frying pan across the kitchen.
He's never done that.
No, this is amazing that, like, sometimes when I go into the Word of God and I don't understand what His Word is saying, What does the Holy Spirit do?
Ask. Seek.
No, but what did the Holy Spirit does, Chelsea?
Oh, oh, oh.
John 14, 26, 27.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He will teach us
all things.
Basically reveal.
I was going to say that.
Yeah.
I was just going to say that.
Yeah.
Reveal.
So young people, what we're trying to say basically is this, is hey, if you don't have a desire to read God's words, all you got to do is ask, hey God, I don't feel like reading a word. Will you please give me the desire to? Since you've given me your Holy Spirit, I should have these desires. This is the new creation, this is the new life that we've been talking about.
Yeah.
So that's it. And also, when I'm reading God's word, every time before I even read, I say, hey God, this is your word.
Living word.
Your living, active word that speaks to me in my current situation. Will you open my eyes, my ears, my heart to hear, to see, and to understand what you are saying to me?
And he will teach you.
That's it.
And reveal.
Reveal himself to us.
Yeah.
And there's another verse I love to show, but maybe next week we'll talk on that. But yeah, that's it. Ask and you will receive.
Yeah.
Any need you have, young people.
Absolutely.
You could be struggling in school. You could be...
impatient.
Yeah.
You could be someone who doesn't like getting out of bed in the morning.
It's not like that. Don't get it twisted. It was only once, okay?
Or someone who doesn't like to go to bed early.
Okay, I do struggle with that.
Chelsea, I can't sleep yet.
That's true. But young people, at the end of the day, you know
God
yourself.
Still loves him.
You know yourself what you need. Not all the time. But there's times in your life when you know you need strength and courage to be salt of the earth, to be light of the world, to basically show the love of Christ to your friends and to share who God is and what he's done in your life.
Yeah.
And that's it.
So we will see you again on Saturday. We hope you had a fun time rock climbing with us. I mean, my arms are still recovering from it. Well, yeah, I'm the weakling, so... we're excited to see you this coming Wednesday and Saturday. We'll see you soon.
Bye!
Hello and welcome to the service. This is Sarah and this is the Family News. But first, a big hello from me and Elia, a virtual hug. And we love you very much and we cannot wait to meet you again. We've missed you a lot. Now to the news. First, a little update with our service plans. During the month of September, the church will be staying with our recorded service model. We are keeping our eyes on the COVID numbers and feedback from the congregation. We will update you as we move forward for our plans for October through our e-blast and the family news when the building is reopening. We have reached the climax of our Friday Covenant series. With this Friday is the final session as we look at the new covenant made by Christ and the Father. All of the previous sessions are on our YouTube channel, and even if you have not attended any of the other ones, we recommend you attend this final session, which is at 7:30 on Friday, www.crossroadschurch.fr/online/Friday. As a new term restarts, it is so important that we stay in prayer. So do remember our corporate Thursday prayer meeting. Alongside the prayer, we will be hearing from different members of the congregation over the coming weeks. So do make the most of this opportunity. www.crossroadschurch.fr/online/Thursday. Finally, following the summer break, our Connect groups are restarting. We have over 15 groups meetings on different days and times. A list can be found on our website at www.crossroadschurch.fr/connectgroups. You can contact Pastor James at crossroadstetley@gmail.com to join one of these groups. The youth program just keeps on growing. As a reminder, this Wednesday, the worship group will be meeting from 6 to 7 p.m. and the creative team will be meeting from 7 to 8 p.m. Also on Saturday, October the 3rd, the next Cross Church youth event is taking place at Crossroads Church from 7 to 9 p.m. Finally, a big thank you to everyone who served and helped at Osage's Thanksgiving service yesterday. It was a wonderful occasion to say goodbye to our brother in Christ. We will now take up the offering. Please take the time to scan the code on the screen or head to the website. Thank you.
While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, all is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I children of God.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say
I am. Chosen.
I am chosen.
Not forsaken.
Not forsaken.
Oh, Lord.
I am who you say I am.
You are for
me. You are for me. Not against me. I am who you say I am.
Yes, I am who you say I am.
Oh, I am who you say I am.
I am delighted again to be able to return to the pulpit of Crossroads Church, and really delighted to be speaking with you, chatting with you, conversing with you about prayer and life, prayer and living, particularly as we are faced with what's upon us is a massive crisis. What does prayer look like in crisis times? But actually, as you'll discover, there's nothing new that the crisis times ought to do upon us, because what we are and ought to be, prayer does determine. So I've been delighted, by the way, receiving some feedback from some about the value of what I shared last Sunday. So I'd like to continue our thoughts, and as we do, focus our attention on what we now have come to know as the Lord's Prayer or the family prayer. I would like us to turn ourselves to the Lord, that by His Spirit He may illumine our minds to understand the truth from His Word, that He will draw our hearts to respond to Him, and that God help me, pray with me, that I will be able to articulate, I'll be able to announce the good news of the gospel in ways that I ought to. So let's pray together. Lord, thank you very much for your goodness and your grace. Thank you that there are no times that are an accident to you. Thank you that there is nothing unknown to you. And thank you that you are God, our Father. You are God that is sovereign, God of history, God of yesterday, today, and forever. And so draw us to yourself, we pray, even as we reflect together on your word. And Lord, help me to be able to communicate this as I ought, to the glory and honor of your name, Jesus our Savior. Amen. Amen. Praying, prayer in crisis times. I hope you got the point last Sunday, that as you engage with the teaching of our Lord, in response to the disciples' plea, Lord, teach us to pray. I hope you got the message that we live what and how we pray. Prayer is life. And we pray how we live our life, how we live our faith life in God. But there is a way in which, you remember when Jesus responds in Matthew, he says, do not be like. When you pray, do not be like hypocrites. Do not be like pagans. Do not be. Jesus seems to be saying very clearly to us that prayer and praying reflects who you are, who we are, our relationship with God. Remember, Daddy, you know, Daddy. Or as well as our view of God. Even our understanding of God's action in the world is actually reflected in how we pray, when we pray, what we understand prayer to be. There is also a sense in which prayer does reflect the imperative, how we understand God's imperative of our lives in the world, a believer living in the world. And so when the disciples say, teach us to pray, there is a way in which they are asking Jesus, teach us to live. Because they have watched him live, and they are yearning, we want to be like you. We want to reflect your life in the world. Last Sunday, I hope it was clear again that the preoccupation, the first things first for the believer, for one who defines his life as belonging to Christ, is Daddy's vision of the world. Daddy, the sovereign one who created the heavens and the earth, on whom everything belongs, your name, your kingdom, your will, that what should preoccupy us are those things. And therefore, our lives ought to be about His will, His kingdom, His name. Today, we ask, what then does His kingdom look like? When God reigns, when God's government is in charge, what does the world look like? What do our families look like? What does it mean to do His will? What is His will? What is it that honors and glorifies God? And it's amazing how in today's reflection on, as I read, let's do, Our Father in Heaven, that's Matthew chapter 6, reading from verse 9. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in Heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I think I need to say something here. Very often, and I met somebody just a little while ago, and we were talking about all the requirements for protecting ourselves from COVID-19 pandemic, you know, the coronavirus that is wreaking havoc. And I mean, it was tongue-in-cheek. She said, for me, I am on my way to heaven, so there's really no big deal. I am good. and I was like, okay. It was a joke. But actually, there's a sense in which a lot of us, of our faith life in God, we sometimes get so preoccupied with heaven, we don't realize that our heavenly life begins here. That it's eternal life, and therefore our preoccupation is how heaven is reflected here. And so, your will, your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. So, our business is here on earth. What then does God's kingdom look like on earth? What does God's will look like? What is it that glorifies God in our lives here on earth as he is glorified in his abode? Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if, Jesus continues, you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. As I have been reading and reflecting on this passage and preached on it several times, there are always insights as every time I come to it. But there are three things, it seems to me, that Jesus emphasizes that should be our preoccupation and should be our longing, that reflect his kingdom, his will, his purpose, his glory here on earth. Three things that seem to come out here. The first is community, life together. The second is food, the things that sustain life. We can add in there shelter. We can add in there, what are the other things that are essential for life to thrive here? We can add work, you know, those things that are important. So food as a representative of those very concrete life experiences that are required for us to live meaningful lives here on earth. And then thirdly, relationships. It's about forgiveness. And he says, how you live with others, that matters to God. And we'll see the value of forgiveness there. So, community. Do you recognize how, right from the beginning, it's our Father, not my Father. It is our Father. It's Daddy together. I told you the story of Joshua, Grace, and Abigail when they were very young, and how they would run together. And each time they said, Daddy, 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 they were not saying, my Daddy. They were saying, our. And Jesus says, when we come, we say, our. It's together we come. Together. Give us this day. Give us. Forgive us. As we forgive, we forgive. As we. Lead us. Do not lead us to the times of trial, but deliver us. Us. How did we miss this? I don't understand. How did we begin to think that the Christian life is personal, individualistic? It is about us together. After all, to be human is to be connected. After all, the understanding of who God is, do you remember in Genesis chapter 1? Let us make human being in our own, let us, God himself, God is community, let us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so who we are to be in the world, we must be informed, it must be guided by this deep commitment to the us, give us, to the we, it's not me. There's so much we could say about the perversiveness of individualism, the perversiveness of self-centeredness. I want to argue, actually, that one of the tragedies of Western society is not that the idols of our times are just money or sex or all of these other things that are all around us. The greatest tragedy of Western society and indeed modern human beings is that they have made the self God himself. It's all about me, 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 myself, my family, my relationships, my food, my security, my. And even in church, I have my worship friend here who is listening, and and we talk together about this and how it is so frightening that even the worship songs, when we gather together in church, the songs we think are I and me and you, Lord, my daddy. No, it's us. And I am now on a crusade to change those. To say, when shall we ever know that together we are together? It's us, our daddy. Give us, forgive us, lead us. Prayer opens our eyes to the other. Prayer causes us to be connected, to recognize that without the other, we cannot be. Theologian and professor John Beattie, who actually lived quite a lot of his life in Bosse, Switzerland, once wrote, and really explaining the ubuntu of Africanness, it's that we are. Because we are, I am. I am because we are. We are us together. And it seems to me that this is essential. This Jesus says. So prayer opening eyes. So it seems to me that one of the critical things in this COVID time is the opening our eyes to the other. And there is a way in which the pandemic has leveled the ground. And maybe, because we divided the world between north and south. We divided the world between rich and poor. We have divided the world between black and white, the race question. Believers who cry to God in Jesus' name, ours is to see the other. For the other's life and our life, my life, are intricately connected. Who is this other? Give us today our daily bread. Give us daily bread. Daily bread. Food. I have suggested we can add there shelter. We can add there work. Give us work. Give us shelter. Give us adequate health care. Give us. It is us. I have a confession to make that there were times when I prayed this prayer with my family, when I prayed this prayer as a student at Makerere University, and I said, give us food. I actually meant it, that there was no food in the house. And so to pray, I really meant it. God, give us food. But let me be honest. Now, I have some money in the bank. Not a lot, but enough. So if I need food, I go to the market. In fact, what do the staff who work with me at home do? They write a list and they give it to me. And they don't say, let's call for a prayer meeting. No, they just give me a list and they ask me, when are you going to the supermarket? When are you going to the market? So I know where to find food. So how then? What's the meaning of this prayer? So here is what Jesus is saying us. Brothers and sisters, there are people in the world for whom life on a daily basis is defined by hunger, is defined by thirst, is lack, is shelter, is a crisis. These existential needs, these very concrete needs. So the first thing that we need to say, the kingdom of God, the glory of God, the will of God is reflected in concrete life, in food, shelter, work. It's real. It's on the ground. It's the family. But secondly, it's that it is together. So I can't, while I have food in the fridge, can't be satisfied. If I have a neighbor who has no food, if I have a friend I know, if I have people in the slums of Kampala who do not have food, I can't. When I say give us, us includes the other. Us includes the other. And the other is not the person who looks like you. The other is the person who is so clearly different from you. If you are white, so-called white, for after all, there are no white people. I discovered the other day. And there are no black people. You know, we're just, what's the color? This is like chocolate what? You know, and the last time I checked, people call them. So anyway, whatever pigmentation of your skin is, the point is this, it's that you are to connect on these concrete life issues. So I was preaching this message at our local church during these times of COVID. And when I finished, I realized that indeed there is a food crisis in Kampala. There is a food crisis. People are literally going hungry. And let me tell you, when I finished, we came back home, talked with my wife about this message. And we began to realize we hadn't actually checked on our neighbors about how they are surviving, because the markets were closed, work was closed, literally everything was closed. And the only places open was the supermarket. Remember this? So if you didn't have money, you had no food. Then the government promised that they would feed the people, and it wasn't happening. So we decided, and this happened actually on a Sunday afternoon, after we had had lunch, we then started to visit. And our eyes were opened to families, to homes. We visited one family, one home, in which the young people there had been simply boiling water. I could tell many more stories. God opened our eyes. And so we came back home. And we found food that we had stored for the tough times. And we realized, how can we be storing food when there are people without food? Thanks be to God for a delightful, remarkable wife. Together, we then took the food distributed. Actually, after that, we raised money so that we could actually feed more people and on and on. I wish we could do more. So, give us. So, if your fridge is full, your bank account is good, it's a responsibility to share with those who do not, the hungry, with those who do not. Give us. Us includes the other, those with whom we need to share. Did you know that God, in creating the heavens and the earth, there is enough to go around? People complain about population explosion. No, there is enough to go around. The tragedy is this, that there are too many who are greedy, who think about themselves. The second comes here. And forgive us. Forgive us our debts. This word debt is excellent, actually. It says that there is something we owe one another. We owe one another. Forgive us when we don't recognize what we owe one another. I like this word debt. It also speaks about our misdeeds, sins of omission and commission, the things we have done and the things we have left undone. And what are they about? It's the things we have done and left undone about the one another. Forgive us. As we have forgiven, wow, that our experience of forgiveness from God is only possible to the extent that we ourselves are able to forgive. Let's put it this way. It is not a condition, by the way, but it is this, that it is, you are only able to appropriate, experience, enjoy his forgiveness, which is done. It's on the cross. He paid it all. He has conquered evil, all the sin structures and powers. But the only way to know that is if you can experience it with the other, the one you have maligned, the one you have the one with whom you are not sharing with. Forgive us as we forgive. The people who experience God's forgiveness are those who see in the other the desire. If you can't forgive the other, you have this sense of pride, you have this, you cannot experience the forgiveness of God. So this is crucial, how we live with one another. Relationships matter. Relationships. This prayer challenges us to ask you, to ask me, how are we, not only in our families, how are we, not only in our church, how are we, especially with the people who are different from us, the people we malign, how are we? Again, I hope you see. Forgive us. as we forgive. For verse 14, Jesus expounds, if you forgive other people, if you forgive other people, I actually discovered that you cannot forgive other people if you have this idea, how could they do it? Has somebody ever done something wrong to you? And you get back home, and it's hurt so much, and you are really bothered. How could they? I thought our relationship, in other words, you are not ready to forgive. As long as you're able to say, how could they? You are saying to sin is just, how is it even possible? That also says you have this mind about yourself, that you are so good, there are things you are incapable of doing. There are sins, you know, the other day I was just thinking how capable I am of killing. I was just shocked. The people I have killed in my mind, you know, I haven't had the opportunity, I think, to take the, I think that's the reason, that's the difference we are, frankly, or other things. So, if you forgive others, in other words, if you are aware of your desperate need, then you will be able to experience forgiveness of the Heavenly Father. Because remember, friends, we don't receive forgiveness because we've asked. Forgiveness is granted to us as God's gift. We have been forgiven. How did you say hallelujah? I know. We have been, but it will be hidden from us if we don't realize. So the appropriation of forgiveness comes in our experience of forgiving others. But if you do not forgive other people's sins, your Father will not forgive you. Forgive us. Relationship. The priority of reconciliation. Wow. Reconciliation between the rich and the poor. Reconciliation between the haves and the have-nots. Reconciliation between the nations of the world. Here in Europe, one of the biggest challenges, I suggest, this whole challenge of immigration, of people crossing the Mediterranean and are dying on the seas, and your politicians, your political leaders are discussing how to close borders. This building of walls reminds me of President Trump and his group. Let's build a wall. No! The genius of the gospel is let's build bridges. Forgiveness. Let's welcome them. I was really gratified, the example of Chancellor Merkel opening Germany. Wow. Let's open. Why? Because there is nothing we do not have that belongs to us. It all belongs to God. Forgive. So, Lord, forgive our greed. Lord, forgive our hatred. Lord, let's pray that prayer. And I suggest these crisis times are reflecting the inequalities in our world. They're reflecting. And so let's, in praying this prayer, I hope we can seek reconciliation. Then lastly, lead us not into temptation. Do not lead us to the time of trial. I think Pope Francis got it right, that the translation here, do not lead us into temptation, is problematic, because it couldn't be that God can lead us to be tempted. God can't lead us to be tempted. So to say, do not lead us to be tempted, is as though to suggest that God tempts. God does not. The right translation, absolutely, is to do with God, protect us. Lord, protect us from the moment of intense trial. Do not allow the times of testing to come upon us. Do not allow them. Here, it's not about temptation to sins. That too, of course, because when we mess up, we mess ourselves, we lead ourselves into all manner of, but the primary one is, brothers and sisters, do you see how these COVID-19 times have tested families, the death of loved ones? And indeed, it's okay for us to pray. God, protect us from the hour of darkness. Protect us from the hour of the darkest moments of our soul. Protect us, we pray. Do not allow those moments to come to us. Do not allow moments in which the world is engulfed in darkness of greed, in darkness of dictators, in darkness of... Do not allow. God, protect. This is a prayer about us. But how do you live it out? It is in choosing that you will be a blessing to others. That those who are experiencing trial, you choose that God, under God, because of the gospel, you choose to be hope. do not lead us. Do not allow the times of trial to come upon us. Well, we must conclude. The point is this. His will and purpose, you and I can experience them here on earth in concrete terms, in community, in our relationships, therefore, in matters of food, just shelter, work. I've been thinking in my own context how this crisis, this coronavirus pandemic has, my God, the amount of unemployment, I mean, youth unemployment in my country and the continent of Africa, of course, you know this in the urban centers, is massive. And in praying during this time, let's not be preoccupied just with our churches. I've been arguing with fellow pastors, apostles, bishops, that instead of crying to governments to open churches, let's talk to governments to end corruption that takes away jobs. Let's talk to governments to open economies in ways in which it is safe so that jobs are available. And so to pray this prayer is to ask that God will open our eyes to the other, and that God will cause us to act, to be instruments of his goodness and of his love, of his power, of his mercy in the world. That you and I will be hope in times of hopelessness. That you and I will be answers to those who have sought for shelter, food. This is something about Crossroads Church. You can't pray this prayer and remain the same. You can't pray this prayer and your budget remains the same. Your family budget, your individual budget, because when you say, give us this day our daily bread, you are including the other who does not. Give us work. You can't just be thankful for the work you have while the others do not have work. Reconciliation, relationships, forgiveness. It is Archbishop Desmond Tutu who wrote, and he was spot on. South Africa has no future without forgiveness. The world has no future without forgiveness. Our societies have no future without forgiveness. Who ought to model that? Who ought to live that? It's the people of God who have understood God's forgiveness in Christ. So praying during these times, I argue, causes us to make a choice to live differently. So let us pray that God will draw us into his life, into his glory, into his kingdom, to live our lives in ways that reflect. And so let's cry to him that our lives will truly reflect his kingdom, his purposes, his will, and his glory. Let's therefore pray that our lives will be lives that see the other, whoever they are, recognizing that God wants to do something fresh because of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. So God, our Father, help us, we pray. God, our Father, help Crossroads Church. Help us in Kampala. Help, Lord. Lord, there is darkness of greed, of corruption over this world. Wars and not generosity, not your grace. Lord, protect us. Protect your people. Protect, we pray, those who are hungry, those who are thirsty, those who have no work. God, help us to be, open our eyes to see what it is that you see. Give us your perspective, O God, we pray, to the world. Give us, forgive us, protect us all together. Your world, your kingdom come, your will be done, your name be honored here on earth as it is in heaven. God, our Savior, Jesus, our Lord. And God's people said, Amen. Thank you very much.
Bishop Zach, we want to thank you on behalf of the elders and pastors of this church. We want to thank you for ministering to us last week and this week. What a great challenge you've left us as a church. We appreciate you, and we certainly will be back in touch and have you on again. May the Lord bless you. And Crossroads Church, if you need prayer, please take a look below me. There is a place that after the service that you can go to and receive prayer today. God bless you. Amen.
signs and wonders from above. When you poured out your spirit on the old and the young, in the power of your presence, Holy Spirit, rain falling like a flood. Break upon my praise as I sing of your love. Holy Spirit, fire, burn within my soul as I call on your name. As I call on your name. As I stand in your presence, revelations of your love, as I look to the heavens, Holy Spirit, rain falling like a flood, break upon my praise as I sing of your love. Holy Spirit, fire, burn within my soul as I call on your name. As I call on. Open heaven, crushing
miracles.
It's all for your glory, it's all for your glory.
Holy Spirit.
Oh, Holy Spirit, burn like a fire. Jesus.